Google Map design is also one of the most complicated system design, as lots of attributes we need to consider while designing such huge system. So let's start from the basics, like what are the primary requirements of the Google Map. So one such requirement is it always tracks the location of the user. So basically, our map system should always track our locations and the movements of each and every users. So let's say we are traveling, then map can get the real data to find out the ETA to reach from the point 1 to the point 2. So this is one of the requirement in the Google Map. Then another requirement is, let's say we are using our map system and then the user will select the destination. So when we use the map, we select some destinations, and according to the longitude and latitude of the source and destination that we selected in our system, it should suggest some path that is the optimal path to reach the destination. That is also one of the primary requirement of the Google Map system. And then the third is ETA, of course. So basically, once our map system shows the path, the main attribute is distance and ETA. Like this is the Google Map system. So this is my ETA to reach from the one point to another point, and then the distance. So these are the two prime attributes while providing the path to the user in our map system. So now lots of factor will come, like this is traffic, that is one of them. Then we can have the weather condition also. Then we can have the road construction that is going on in between. So all these factors actually affect the ETA to reach from the source to the destination. So we need to consider all those attributes while designing our system. Now let's consider the simple case. Like this is my map and this is my source, let's say. And from this source, I want to find out the distance between the source and this particular destinations. So one obvious solution is that every unique point in the map must have the unique value of longitude and latitude. Like these two points have the unique value of longitude and latitude. So we can apply any kind of algorithms to find out the distance between the two points, that is source and destination. So we can use, let's say, Nijkastra algorithm to find out the distance between these two points. But here we have the problem. And the problem is this approach won't work in the real project. Why? Because our app will be used by the millions of users. In fact, we have the millions of different routes are also present throughout the globe. So imagine millions of users are using those millions type of routes. So this kind of computations of using some algorithms on the real time doesn't work that. So one possible solution is, in this case, we will store all these distances and their ETA between major junction into the cache. So we use the cache, and whatever the distances we compute between the important junctions, we will store into the cache. And then whenever we need, we just take from the cache. But in this case also, we need a very huge cache to store the distance and ETA informations between all the major junctions. And as you can see that we have the millions of roads throughout the globe. So we need to store all such informations in the huge cache. And sometimes, if you know that this traffic also vary the ETA time between the two important points. During traffic conditions, ETA will vary every 10 minutes between two points. So how we store all such data into the huge cache? And also we have the weather issues also. Due to the weather also, sometimes ETA between the two points vary a lot. Then let's say some road construction is going on. So if between these two points some road construction is going on, then also the ETA will vary between these two points. So that also information also we supposed to update into our cache. Then let's say government will install some traffic light in this route, then the ETA will again vary. So a lot of factors are there which actually change the ETA between the source and the destinations. Let's say another is that new route has been introduced between these two points, then also that we need to get updated. Then let's say between these two points some particular road that is newly created, and now we need to find out the efficient route between the source and the destinations. So that is also one of the primary requirements that we need to consider while designing the map system. Then let's say the user is using this particular route to going from the source to a destination, and in between it deviates from the route. Then again we need to compute the updated distance between this point and the destinations and show that to the user. So that is also one of the primary requirements. So all these factors we need to consider while designing a huge system like a Google Map. Let's take all these problems one by one. First, assume that in our scalable map, we need to just find the optimized route between the two points. So currently you can ignore this kind of attributes like the traffic or let's say the weather conditions or let's say the some kind of road construction is going on. So currently we are simply find out the optimized route between the two junctions in the map. So here also we use the same concept that we have used during the Uber design problem, that is quad tree. So if you are not aware of this quad tree, please check the Uber design problems. So basically this quad tree kind of system is mostly used in all kind of design problem where we need to compute the distance or the time between the two points in the map. So what is this quad tree? Well, in this quad tree, this route represents the world map. And then all these branches represent the different regions. So we divide the world map into the four parts, first, second, third, and fourth. Then we again subdivide this region into the four different parts, that is 1, 2, 3, and 4. And this process will be keep on doing it. So basically we divide the regions into the sub-regions, and this process will keep on happening in every level. This division process will continue until we're left with the one specific regions, or you can say the leaf of this quad tree, where let's say we have the 10 kilometer of length and 10 kilometer of width. Then we stop our division process there, and that is the leaf of this quad tree. So let's say one such region is this one, where the length is 10 kilometer and width is let's say also 10 kilometer, and this is one of the leaf of this quad tree. Now I want to find out the distance between the two point in this particular region. So let's say I will take the first point as A and second point of B, and I need to compute the distance between A and B. So one such obvious solution is we will use some distance algorithms and find out the distance between the A and B and store that result into our cache. Now let's say this is my C and this is my D, and now I need to find out the distance between C and D. So rather than finding out the distance between C and D, what we can do is we already have the efficient distance between A and B. So we just calculate this specific distance, and then we calculate this specific distance, and then take this distance, that is between A and B, from our stored locations. Let's say you can consider some cache, and then find out the distance between C and D. So within the region, if we want to find out the distance between the two points, we can efficiently find out by using our algorithms and take the data from the cache. Now what if the case is the user is this particular region and the user wants to go to some other regions, like the destination for the user is in some other regions. So we have the different regions are there, and let's say the user is at region 1. So let's say this is my region 1 and user wants to go to region 3. So in such scenario, for this particular case, we will consider something called a exit and entry point. So basically these are the points from which you can go from the region 2 to region 3. So let's say these are my exit point from region 2 and entry point to region 3. Similarly, let's say this is my point through which we can go from the region 1 to region 2. So like that, we have the exit and entry point. And let's say you already calculated the distance between these points. Like if you want to go from region 1 to region 3, then these are my two different routes. Now somehow, if we know the efficient distance between this exit and entry point across the region, then we can use it to find out the efficient route. Like let's say in this case, the user is at A and the user wants to go to B, that is in different regions. And we already computed that the distance between this point and this particular region is this one. This is the efficient distance, let's say. So in that case, we just need to calculate this distance, and then we just need to calculate this distance through our algorithms, and then we can use this distance that we have already calculated, which is efficient, and take from the cache and then find out the distance between the point A and point B, and we can store that. So like that, we can manage to find out the efficient route when the two different points are in two different regions. So like we can store all such informations across the regions into the cache, and let's say this is my exit point from this specific third region. Let's say if you want to go to this point, and this is my exit point from the region 3, and this user A wants to go to this point D, and we already know that the efficient distance between this point and this point is this particular route. So we already computed this, so we can take that value from the cache and we just need to calculate this distance and then this distance, and we can simply take that data, compute it, and return the result to the user. Calculation of all such distances is fine, but what about the ETA? Because the attributes like traffic affects the ETA time. Like whenever we have to find out the ETA between the two points in the map, we need to consider the traffic factor also. So in such cases, like one obvious solution is we take the real-time data from the different users and then calculate ETA based on it. Like consider, these are my two different points, that this is the point A, let's say this is the point B, and I want to find out the ETA between these two points. Distance we can easily able to calculate, but we need to find out the ETA based on the traffic. So what we can do, like lot of users are currently in the last, let's say 10 minutes or 15 minutes, are traveling between these two points, that is A and B. So based on the data of all such users, we can do some kind of computations. Like let's say we use the standard deviations for all such datas, use some analytics, and try to find out the approximate ETA time between the point A and B, and then display that to the users when the user are searching the ETA between point A and B in our map. So this is one of the obvious solution. We take the data from all the users traveling between these two points, use some kind of computations like standard deviations for all such points, and return result to the user. Now in this kind of approach, in map, we need to show some quantity data. So we create a table where we measure the ETA. Like this table represents the traffic. Like let's say these are my two different points, that is A and B, and we calculate the ETA between these two points is approximately 60 minutes. So this is huge. Like you are taking 60 minutes of time to reach from the point A to point B. So in our table, we can show that this as a red mark. It means that particular route is taking a lot of time. Similarly, we can mark all those routes in different colors, like yellow or let's say green. So green means that between these two points, it is taking very less time. So we can mark it as a green. So like that, we can quantify our data into the map. Let's see which all services are involved in our system. So the first one is user location service. So basically, this user location service is used for the user profiling. Like let's say the user device, whether it's a mobile or it's an iPad, will sense the continuous user locations, and we store it in our NoSQL database to perform the further analytics. So it's a responsibility of this user location service to get continuous detail from the user mobile or let's say user iPad, and then give the detail to our system, and system will store that into some NoSQL DB so the system can perform the further analytics. Please note, in Google Map type of service, we need to do a lot of real-time streaming of data and perform analytics over it real-time. So it's better to use some kind of system like Spark streaming or let's say the Kafka in our system. Then the next service is route update service. So our map suggests one route to the user in our system. Then if the user has taken, let's say, the new route, then based on its location updates, we add a new route in our map service. So like that, we keep on updating our map system. So we have suggested some route to the user from A to B, but user has taken some different path, and that path is more efficient. So it's a responsibility of this particular service to get that detailed locations and update that into the system so we can add a new route in our map. Then the next service is find location service. So this service will return the longitude and latitude data for every specific point in the map. Like let's say the user will select some destination in the map. So this service will search and return the longitude and latitude of that point in the map or of that destination in the map. Mostly we use the Elasticsearch for this type of search queries, where we store all the geographical locations and their corresponding latitude and longitude informations. Then we have get historical info service. So basically we can also sometimes use the past traffic logs at a particular location or at a particular time interval, so we can find out the ETA. So what that means? So it means, let's say this is my point A and this is my point B, and we know that between these two points, sometimes, especially in the weekend, the traffic is more, or let's say in the Friday night, the traffic is more in this particular route. So we have this historical data, we have the past data, and we have the logs. So on the basis of that log or data, we can perform some analytics and then return the ETA to the user based on the previous logs that we have. So this is the responsibility of this service, which is guest historical info service. Then we have traffic update service. So as the name suggests, this service gets the real-time ETA details in the routes based on the traffic. And then correspondingly, this service will update that details into the NoSQL DB that we have chosen. Also, it updates all the entries corresponding to all the regions we have. So what it means, let's say this is your one region, and in this region, let's say between A and B, these are the two points are there. And we have the updated ETA details between these two points, that is A and B, based on the traffic. So we have a lot of users that are traveling from point A to point B, and we have the real-time data of those users. Now, based on that, this service will calculate the ETA and correspondingly update the ETA between A and B into the DB. Now, that is the one part of it. Now, another part is, let's say we have the lot of regions in our system. So in this particular region, which is region second, we are traveling from this point, that is C, to this point, that is D. And that also traveling, this point is also coming towards A and B, and then eventually move to D. Now, as the traffic that between A and B point is increased, it means now, previously we have chosen this particular path to go from C to D. But currently we know that between A and B, based on the real-time data we got from all the different users that are traveling between A and B, the traffic is increased and this part becomes red. So in that case, in our system, that is traffic update service will suggest some other path from point C to point D. Please note, this C is in a different region and this D is in this different region. But as this path we have chosen previously and store that information into the cache, but now as this path is having the highest traffic, then we can suggest some different route to the users. So like that, it will get updated through all the different regions. Like let's say if I talk about this region, and previously we suggest this path to reach from C to D. But if the traffic between A and B is increased a lot, then in that case, from this region also, we will suggest some different path to the user. So all those stuffs will be done by the traffic update service. So these are all responsibility of the traffic update service. And then we have the route processing service. So this is the most important service of our system. In fact, this service compute the distance, the actual distance between the two points when the user send queries. So it's a responsibility of this service to perform all the computations and return the exact distance by using some algorithms. So either it pick the informations from the table, let's say whatever we have stored into our NoSQL DB, or if the information is not available currently, then it compute the distance using some algorithms and then store that information into the DB. So all the processing tasks or computation tasks will also be done by this particular service, that is route processing service. And then we have the last one, which is navigation tracking service. So this service continuously tracking the users, and the responsibility of this service is to suggest some route to the user while they are using our app. And then while using the app, if the user diverted from a suggested route that we have given to the user, then that is also captured. So those, that particular route will also be captured by this service, that is navigation tracking service. And then correspondingly do the analytics on top of that. Like for example, let's say we are at point A, and then we have to go to the point B, and we have suggested one route to the user. But in between this point, if the user has taken some other path, then it's a responsibility of this navigation tracking service to get the detail of that path. And also, it suggests the user that when the user has to take left, when the user has to take right, inform the user that you have taken some different route. So please come back to the same route that we have suggested. So all this communication with the user has done through the navigation tracking service. Let's see the low level design of the system. So all the services that we just discussed, we are going to use it in our design. Start with the user. So basically this is my user, and this user is accessing our map service using, let's say, mobile, and we need his location continuously. So our app is continuously sending the user location to the load balancer, and then this load balancer will send that information to this service. So this is our service, that is user location service. So this service will do the user profiling. So it gets all the details of that user, like what is the current location of that user, and correspondingly it update all these details into the NoSQL DB. So we can use any kind of a NoSQL DB like Cassandra or MongoDB in this particular place. So Why we are storing all these details? Because we can do a lot of analytics over this data that we are storing. So let's say if the user is traveling right now, then we need the ETA between the two points where the user is traveling. So that information will be useful for us to show to other users also. And in fact, lots of people are gathering in some place. Then our system can assume that around that area, traffic is going to increase. So all these analytics we want to do. So that's why we need to keep on getting the details about the user locations. In fact, all the user locations that are using our services. Now, this user location service will send that detail to a particular topic to Kafka. And then we have the Spark streaming, which read that data. So this is the module which does all the analytics. So this Spark streaming used for the scalable, high throughput, and fault tolerant stream processing of live data streams. So I'm talking about the live data stream that has been done by the Spark streaming. So data can be taken from any source. Like in this case, we are reading the data from the Kafka, and this Spark streaming are using for the complex algorithms, like through high level functions like map, reduce, join, windows. So a lot of functions has been used inside this Spark streaming module. It uses a complex algorithm and try to do a lot of computations. Like in this case, let's say if the user requests for ETA between the two points, then that computation has been done by the Spark streaming based on the data that is being stored in our DB. Similarly, let's say if the new route has been added into the system, or let's say user has taken some new route between point A and B, so that update will be also be done by the Spark streaming. Or similarly, let's say public gathering. So in a particular place, a lot of people are gathered. Then around that area, there is a possibility that the traffic is going to increase. So all those analytics will be done by the Spark streaming. So once this data is processed in this particular module, then it can push the processed data out to some kind of distributed file system. Like let's say, you can say Hadoop, we can transfer that data and apply any kind of machine learning stuffs over there. Or what you can do is, you can again write back all these informations into the Kafka on a particular topic. So in our case, we can take any path, we can transfer all those information to the Hadoop clusters, or we can again write all those details in a particular topic in Kafka. And then these two services will read that information. That is route update service and the traffic update service. So whatever the data that Spark streaming write into the Kafka on a particular topic, these two services will read it correspondingly. So this route update service will, let's say, add a new route into our map service. Similarly, this traffic update service, this service get a real ETA details in our route based on the traffic. And correspondingly, these two services will update those details into the DB. Let's see another scenario, like the user search one destination in our map. So basically, user want a particular ETA between his locations and the destinations. So that request will also land at the load balancer, and load balancer transfer that request to the find location service. And the responsibility of this service is to return the longitude and latitude of source as well as destinations. And how it returned that? So it communicated that through Elasticsearch. So Elasticsearch has the geographical locations of all the different points in the map in the form of longitude and latitude. So we can do all kind of search queries very efficiently by using the Elasticsearch. So it will return the longitude and latitude of the source as well as its destinations. And then those details will also be written into the Kafka for further processing. So now, once we have the longitude and the latitude of source and destination, then all the processing is done by the route processing service. So basically, it's the responsibility of the route processing service to return the optimized route to the user. And how it returns that? So basically, it will try to get the detail from the cache. So these two services are already updated the detail into the DB. Then the route processing service will try to communicate with the Kafka and read on a particular topic and then get the detail regarding the efficient route between the source and destination and return that details to the user. Let's say between these two points, if there is no route that is currently present in our DB, then in that case, this route processing service will compute that distance using some algorithms, correspondingly store that into the DB and return also the same route to the user. So that's how the end-to-end processing of the Google Map works.